In this video, we are going to first understand what are the different server controls we have, and then more precisely, we'll specifically talk about few basic controls like label, literal control, text box, and so on. So yes, we have got two categories of controls, we can call it. One is HTML server control and the other is web server controls. HTML server controls are generally like this. I'll take a new project. New website. About controls, about basic controls. I would go to toolbox, HTML, drag and drop button. To be noted, it's ordinary HTML button. It is not even a server control. Like that, drag and drop text box, ordinary text box, not even a server control. So generally these controls are used in case we want to program the controls on browser in JavaScript and we don't want to program them on server in ASP.NET. But by chance, in case we want to do something with these controls in ASP.NET, you can actually add here runat is equal to server. Now this becomes a server control, a server side HTML control, and then there'll be a class representing this also on server, and those classes are under the namespace system.web.ui.html controls. For text box, we'll have a class called as HTML text box, HTML button, and so on. But generally these controls are nowadays not required. They actually were useful to an extent in framework 1.1, but from 2.0 onwards, they're not so significantly used in our project, because for most of the requirements, we would preferably use web server controls, which are considered to be a little faster and more optimized and more flexible also. So earlier there were certain things which web server controls could not do. In such cases, people had to go for HTML controls, HTML server controls. But now most of the jobs we can do it with the web server control itself from framework 2.0. Hence the importance of HTML controls in programming web form is almost eradicated. So we use HTML control, but we don't use HTML server controls. What is the difference? HTML control without runat is equal to server is an ordinary text on server, but it becomes a control in browser like ASP style of programming. So in case we want to do a control only with client-side JavaScript programming, we can go for HTML control. Otherwise, we will always go for web server control. And I would say all these are web server controls. All these except HTML, all are actually web server controls only. And all these web server controls fall under the namespace system.web.ui.webcontrols, and rest are classes like label is a class, literal control is a class, button is a class, text box is a class, link button is a class, image button is a class. All these are classes otherwise. So let us see now how to use them. First, I'll drag and drop label on my form. I'm trying to show you here how you should learn a control so that any control you should be able to make use of tomorrow when needed. So I drag and drop here a label. Set the text for the label. This is demo text. Now when you execute this, output will be shown in the browser. Important thing is go to view, source, and see for label what is rendered. Label is rendered as span tag. And the content, the text property of the label is rendered as the HTML content inside the span tag. Let us see now, if I put here B tag, what's going to happen. Run. You'll see that the B tag is marking the demo as bold. I don't want like this. Whatever is the tag, as it is, it should come. So in such case, we have to set this property programmatically. So how to do this? Let us give the ID as LBL demo. Press F7. It will take you to the code view. And here I'll say LBL demo dot text is equal to so and so. Additionally, I will do here server dot HTML encode. Now let us see what happens. HTML encode. Why like this? Because now the output rendered is the HTML encode will convert less than symbol to ampersand LT semicolon, greater than symbol to ampersand GT semicolon. So this is what is referred as HTML encode, and the function takes care of doing it. We don't have to do it manually character by character. So a label can show formatted text, unformatted text. If you want formatted, don't do anything, just put tags within it. But if you don't want to format the text, whatever text property you are assigning to label, encode that and then assign it. Next, we have got literal control. Now the important thing is, what is the difference between literal control? This is literal text. Run this. Label literal control. Now what is the difference between this? Simple. Select label, go to property window, you'll find so many properties, specifically background color, border style, border width, right? Background color and so on. Select literal control, go to properties, you'll find except text, nothing. So how does this work? This is because of background color for label. Now look at page source. What you'll understand is literal control is plain text without tag. Literal control is going to render plain text without tag, whereas span tag is rendered because of label, and hence label can be formatted. Style, literal control cannot be formatted. So keep this difference in mind. In case we want formatted text, we will use label. We don't want formatted text, we simply want plain text, we can use literal control. Preferably use literal control, in formatting is not required because it's rendering lesser output. This is all extra for label. So output size has increased. Clear? What if I put here in literal control some tag, let's say B tag. Run. It will show formatted because B tag has come there as it is. Now for literal control, we have a property called as mode. Change that to encode. Now run this, you will find the text is encoded. How? Same. So literal control mode property decides whether its text should be encoded automatically or it should not be, whereas this feature is not there in label. We have it in literal control. Comma mode. Next, text box. Text box can render either input type text or input type password or text area tag. And on what basis it decides what to render? There is a property text mode. If text mode is single line, it renders input type text. If text mode is password, then it renders input type password. And if the text mode is multi-line, then it renders text area. Then we already know what is read-only text box, max length attribute of the text box, and auto-post back. That means if I type some text in the text box and lose the focus, automatically using JavaScript, the form is going to be posted to server to execute text changed event handler of the text box. So this is auto-post back. Then next is button. Button is going to render itself as one button, another button. For the second button, there is a property called as use submit behavior. I am setting that to false. First button use submit behavior is true. Now look at view source. So for the button, if use submit behavior is true, it renders input type submit. Whereas if use submit behavior is false, it renders input type button. When you click on submit button, form is submitted. Same thing will happen even if you click on the second submit button, which is actually not a submit button, which is an ordinary button. But through JavaScript, the form will get posted to server. And you already know do postback posts the form. So just for the demo, click here, it will do a post back. Click here, also it will do a post back. Now, just that was just for the information. About button, what is important thing I want to do now is, if I click on the button, first I want to show a confirmation whether to submit or not. And only if confirmed, it should be submitted. Otherwise, it should not be submitted. So how do we show confirm? For that, we are supposed to write onClick is equal to return confirm. We have done this in the JavaScript video, but still, how to do the same thing here now? See, the requirement is in output, it should be something like input type submit and on click is equal to return confirm. Are you sure? I want this to be the output. Now, see the problem. For button tag, double click on the button. Now go back. So for the button tag, you'll note that onClick is mapped to some function, which is a server side function, server side event handler. But my requirement is onClick should be mapped to a JavaScript function in the HTML output which is rendered. So on server, which property I have to set? There is a property called as on client click. On client click. And here I'll give return confirm. Are you sure? So this is supposed to be, put semicolon, don't forget. This is supposed to be some JavaScript code which is going to execute when I click on the button on the client machine. Let us see. Now click here. Are you sure? Cancel. Are you sure? Okay. So what is output generated? View source. You see here, what we have is input type submit, name is equal to good, good. On client click property on server got rendered as on click attribute in the browser, and hence when I click on the button on the client, this function will execute. Confirm. If confirm returns true, form will be submitted. If confirm returns false, form will not be submitted. So this on client click is mostly used like this only for the button to decide whether to submit the form or not to submit the form. But otherwise also you can call some function, JavaScript function in on client click, so that the function can do some extra processing before the form is submitted to server. Before the form is submitted to server, that is important. So this is button. Button on client click will be rendered as on click. And we already know if on click returns false for a submit button, the form will not be submitted to server. So let us now see, similar to button, we have got link button and image. How to work with these controls? Simple. So drag and drop link button, drag and drop image button. Link button, you can set the text property. Click here, and you can handle server side click event. And for link button also we have got on client click, where we can execute some JavaScript code. So here also we can say return confirm, are you sure, run, click here, cancel, it's not submitting, click here, okay, it is submitting. So this is input type submit, but what is this tag? Pretty obvious, that is a tag, but a tag is supposed to have href mapped to a URL. In this case, a tag will be mapped to a URL, but the URL is again JavaScript, which is do postback. So href need not be always a URL. It can be JavaScript, and the JavaScript will be executing. That's it. So that's how link button. Now link button, similar look and feel is for hyperlink. How are they different? Let us say I add a new item here, default 2.aspx. So here I want hyperlink to default 2.aspx. So go to properties, default 2, and you can give navigate URL as default 2.aspx. Now when I click on this, it's navigating to a new page altogether, whereas here it will do a post back. So what is the difference between hyperlink and link button? Link button is going to do a post back, hyperlink is going to navigate you to a new page altogether. Also, if you want for hyperlink, you can give target, specifically underscore blank. So when you click on this hyperlink, it will show a new window with the file content. So make sure you clearly distinguish when to use Sorry, when to use hyperlink and when to use link button. Next is image. First, let us get the image. We have this in HTML folder. We'll copy this to about basic controls. Right? Then come here, right click and say refresh folder. We got the images. And the standard practice actually is we'll create a folder by name images, and images we will move to that folder. Now this is image button, so go to properties, image URL you have to give. Big image this is. Yeah, you can actually shrink it to whatever size you want. So what is the difference between link button and image button? Link button is a tag with href map to JavaScript do post back. Image button is input type is equal to image and it will do the post back. Similarly, for hyperlink, I can give image URL. But problem is, for hyperlink, when you give image URL, the size of the image you cannot change. And what is that which is rendered? When you click on this, new window will open. Earlier for hyperlink we had text, but now we have image URL. How? Go here to see the source, and for a tag hyperlink we have got href and all this fine. Inside the a tag we have got image. And we cannot change the width and height of this image. That is the basic concern. So we have the choice of either using hyperlink or image. So here we clearly distinguish button, link button, hyperlink, image button. We have done a comparative study. Please concentrate on that. So actually, based on the output required, we have to use any of these controls for submission to a new page or to the same page. Now we have got checkbox. Checkbox is going to render itself as input type is equal to checkbox. And then we have got text. Do you want text on the right hand side of the checkbox or left hand side of the text box? That can be decided with text align property. Checkbox can be checked or unchecked. Checkbox when you checked, if you want to submit the form to server, you can again use auto postback true. Default is auto postback false. And on server for checkbox, the event is checked changed. So nothing special. Radio button. It is inherited actually from checkbox class. So everything which is here is also here. The extra property which radio button has, group name. This is required for grouping the radio buttons. We have done all this in sample programs. Now the list control. How is this list control going to be useful? See, to be noted here, list control is an abstract class by itself. List control cannot be instantiated. We have got classes, drop down list, list box, checkbox list, radio button list, bulleted list. All these are classes which are inherited from list control. So the properties here are inherited from list control. So what are the properties of list control? Items. To add all the list item to the items collection. Selected index, selected item, selected value, text. There is the text of selected item and auto postback. And we have a method called as clear selection. So if something is selected and nothing should be selected now, simply execute the method clear selection. And then we have last an event called as selected index changed. So let us take one by one. I'll start with drop-down list. But before that, you also see here list item has three properties: text, which is displayed, value, which is submitted, and selected, true or false, boolean type. If the list item is selected, it will be true. If not, it will be false. So I'll start with drop-down list. We have already done before. Let me add one more. Default 2 is there. Here only we will put drop-down list. Now, in drop-down list, what do we add? List item. It can go on. Let us say this is some list, drop down list. Now if I run this page, we got drop down list. Which tag? We know it is select tag. And to be noted, we don't have size attribute. Now change from drop down list to list box. That's it. Now run this. We got list box. How is this output different? Everything is same except for now we having size attribute. Otherwise everything is same. Then we have checkbox list. All checkboxes will be rendered. All checkboxes. Similarly, if you go for radio button list, all radio buttons will be rendered. So in drop down list, radio button list, only one list item can be selected. In checkbox list, always we can select multiple list item. In list box, we can select one or more based on selection mode property. Selection mode is true, or sorry, multiple, it will allow multi-selection. Selection mode is single, it will allow only single selection. So now for this checkbox, I'll give auto postback is equal to true. And let us also put a label here. Now go to design view. For checkbox list, we have one property called as repeat columns. I can give it as, let's say, 3. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is because repeat direction is vertical. In vertical direction, repeat. Now change repeat direction to horizontal. Now it is horizontal repeat. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now for checkbox list handle, selected index change. For all of them, the event is same: list box, drop down list, checkbox list, radio button list. But in case of checkbox list, multiple items can be selected. So if multiple items are selected, how do we handle the issue? Now use for each list item in list dot items. Every item is of type list item, and hence for each list item. we have to check if the list item is selected or not. If it is selected, dot text is equal to list item dot text. So I'm just appending the text of all selected list item to the label, and I'm resetting it every time, because if I uncheck the item, that should be removed from the label too. Control F5. Working fine. So this is how we will work with list control. Please go through all these things about each one of them, what they render, and this is what I have done. And if it is single selection, you'll simply use selected value. Multi selection, you have to use this loop. One more control I would like to take up is file upload control. This is something very useful. Now, generally, this file upload control is used for uploading the file from browser machine to server machine, so that this file can be then saved on the server. A btn save file. File upload some demo. I'll keep it as file upload one. Easy. Now, first thing to be noted, form tag, you see run at server and ID, and now you see the form tag. It has method, action, all fine. Important thing is it will also now have multipart slash form hyphen data as the value for ENC type, which is automatically taken care of. Now I'll click on browse. File open dialog box will come, wherein I can specify a file of the local machine, client machine file we are able to specify. C colon slash some file name. Say something. Now when I submit, the content of this file is going to be submitted to server. But point is, on server, do we need all this path? Not required. On server, what is only needed is just the file name, because that path is of the client machine, which is irrelevant to the server machine. So what shall I do first thing? Here, I'll create one folder called as uploaded files. In uploaded files, I would like to save all the files which are uploaded to server. How to do this? All this will happen when I click on save button. So here I'll give first thing, if file upload dot has file. That means if an invalid path is given in the file upload control in the browser, or if the content of the file is not uploaded to the server, has file will be false. So only if it has files, then we would like to save the file. How? File upload one dot save is the method, but save as needs as parameter the file name, and that file name is supposed to be the path of the file on server, and that to a physical path. That means it should start with C colon. Now, how do we get the physical path? String file name is what file upload one dot file name, but this file name only contains the file name submitted by browser to server. To this, I'll precede tilde slash uploaded files slash plus. Now what is this tilde? Tilde is supposed to be the path of your web application, root directory of your web application. So if your web application name is demo app, tilde basically means demo app. If your web application name is demo app 2, tilde means demo app 2. So in this example, my application name is about basic control. So tilde will be about basic control. In that root directory, we have got uploaded files, and in uploaded files, I want the file name. So this path is actually referred as virtual path, virtual path of the file. This is virtual path. But what is needed? Physical path. Now how do we get physical path? In server, we have a method called as map path. To this, you pass virtual path and it returns physical path. And that physical path we can give here. But also important point you have to take care of is that folder where you are trying to upload, which is uploaded files, you should have proper permissions, security, and that too you should give permission to the user ASP net. Let us see. Now run this. Browse some file, click on save. Now how do I know whether it is uploaded or not? Go to solution, refresh, uploaded files, refresh, and we have the file. Now sometimes before I save, I may want to probably check if there is another file with the same name or not. How will I check that? If system.io.file.exists, then what to do? We'll just say response.write. File is already existing, else only we will save the file. So let's try now. One more bracket. File is already existing. Take a new file. Something bib.dll, save file, it will be saved. Try to again give the same file. And moreover, you see file upload control doesn't retain its state. Once the file is uploaded to the server, it clears the text from the file upload control so that the same file doesn't get re-uploaded on subsequent round trip. So this is how a file upload control can be used for updating the for uploading the file to the server. Important thing is you have to understand in this video, my basic idea is you have to see based on your HTML requirement, which is the most appropriate control on the server, and if you have selected a particular control, how can you customize the control for its properties so that the appropriate output can get rendered to the browser. That point is what you have to catch up here, so that you can learn other controls, whichever are new controls coming up, most of the times on your own, without every time needing to refer to some material. You just need to probably go to MSD and look at the properties, methods and events for each and every control and go in depth. That's all in this video. Thank you.